Okay, I think we're on. What's going on? Poor wireless connection. All right, hopefully we got everything set up here. Okay, so what's going on, guys and gals? I'm Noah Neiman. I'm going to be taking over Revealed Recordings' Facebook Live page today to show you exactly how I put together my new track with Anna Yvette, Told You So. I'm going to be taking you on kind of a tour of the project file and kind of answer any questions that you guys have. But we're going to chill for a few minutes, just a little while, so that we can get a few more people online. That way some questions will be coming in. If you have any, though, feel free to ask them right now. I'm going to set things up a little bit for us here, and we'll go ahead and start the show and just a couple of minutes, so just waiting on a few people to show up, okay? So let's see. So Malik Kalai, I'm from Austin, Texas, man. Nice to meet you. Okay, what's my favorite cereal? Man, you know what? I skip breakfast every day, so my favorite cereal is nothing, but I do have a fresh brew right here. My favorite beer is Dogfish Head. This one is for this one is from Delaware. Delaware. It's from a place called Dogfish Head. It's a 90-minute IPA. Say my name, Maximilian Fuz. Do I speak Spanish, bro? Un poquito, Manuel. Muy poquito. Israel, I'm doing good, man. How are you? Any piano plug-in, Daniel? You know what, man? Yeah, I actually just use Nexus. That's pretty much it. Jonathan, yeah, go vote for Hardwell. So, okay, looks like we've got quite a few people on here. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started, guys. If you feel like asking some questions, feel free. I might miss some of them, so if you want, you can go ahead and hold off the questions until the end, because I will let you know when we're going to start the question and answer process. So let me know when you can see the screen, because I'm going to have to darken it up a little bit. Can you guys see that all right? Okay, I'm going to take everybody's silence as a yes. Okay, all right, let's start here. Okay. So let's go through the song. I won't be going through every part because that's probably going to take a few hours, but I'm going to show you guys just kind of the important parts here. So this is Ableton Live. It's the digital audio workstation that I work in. For those of you that aren't familiar with producer lingo, DAW is what we call them. But okay, so let's just go ahead and get into it. Where's my cursor? There it is. All right. So let's just go ahead and start with the kick. This is a sample that I got off of the Sample Foundry website. Just a really simple kick right there. No, I'm not Dutch. I'm from Texas. So I don't have a Texas accent, y'all, but I do live here. I'm a Texas boy through and through. It's a simple kick. Here, I'll play it for you guys. Not sure if you can hear it, but it's just a simple, pretty straightforward kick. A little bit of processing on it. I've got this SSL EQ on there. And as you can see, I took out just a little bit, about three decibels of mid on there. Well, it's actually kind of high mids. It's actually about 1,600 kilohertz. With this EQ, and I kind of just did that because I wanted to make a little bit of room for everything else in the track, and this kick is actually a little bit muddy, in my opinion, up there. So I had to take out a little bit there, and then I used this EQ8 in Ableton Live, just sort of as a filter. So you can see I've taken off just a little bit of the highest end right there. I probably could have left that in there and wouldn't have made too much of a difference, but I just felt like when I had it soloed,
it sounded better with the top end cut off right there. So, all right. Yeah, Kuzi Inan. Yeah, man, it's it's late for you guys. I'm sorry about that. I'm actually a doctor, guys, and so I was in my clinic until about 5 o'clock this afternoon. So I couldn't do this normally when Revealed likes to do things, which is usually at 1 o'clock my time. But you know, you gotta do what you gotta do, right? Okay, so that's the main kick. That's actually the same kick that was used in the drop. So I mean, I can kind of show you here. Same kick right there. But I've also got this acoustic kick, which is kind of interesting. It's actually a sample of a real kick drum. So you can hear that. You know? And that's actually one of the guys from the Mutants, a band here that I work with here in Austin. Has a kick drum, and I kind of sampled that off of it. And I actually like to use this sample in a lot of my songs. I used it in Gasoline too, but I really only use it during the verses of the song, so you can kind of tell. Let's see. It's only in the verse right here. But it's not actually in the drop, and I really only use it during breaks because I don't think it's punchy or powerful enough for the drop. So that's kind of my thing. Manrico, yeah, I do use sidechain for pretty much everything, including the sub, and we'll get to that. We'll get to that in a second here. So hang on. Carlos Romo, yes, I am a doctor. I'm an eye doctor. So that's why I couldn't get here on time, because I was in the clinic. But, okay, so next up, let's take a look at the sub bass. So there you go. We're right there, Manrico. So the sub bass, let's see, it's actually a little bit more complex than you would think. So it's massive. This is a synthesizer. Again, for those of you that aren't super familiar with... the standard stuff that we kind of use in production. This is a really popular synthesizer called Massive. It's by Native Instruments. I use it quite a bit, in the song, in fact. So you'll kind of see that. But the sub is really a lot more complex than you would think, because a lot of people usually just use a single sine wave. But mine's a little bit more complex. You can see all the, the routing and that kind of thing. I'll play it for you. I'm not sure if you'll actually even be able to hear it because it is a sub bass, and my iPhone camera microphone probably won't be able to pick it up. But let's see. So. Yeah, that's it right there. I'm not sure. I hope you guys could hear that. And basically, I've just taken off, you can see right here, I've taken off the high end, and then I've added in a saturator, which is Ableton's own saturator. So, it's kind of interesting there. I just added a little bit of harmonics to the top end. That's what that saturator does. And then, yes, right here, this is the sidechain. So it kind of gives it that like pumping, pumping, breathing feel. And again, that's going to be on pretty much everything that I produce. So synths and bass and even some drums, that kind of stuff. And we'll get to all that in a second here. Okay, and next up, you know what? Let's look at the chords here. So I've got some chords, and so there's three layers right here. There's three layers that are stacked, and this right here is just the intro. And let me play it for you guys a little bit. I'm gonna play just the chords. And so I kind of like having the part of the melody in the intro because it kind of gives you a sense of the main part of the song right away. Tracks that start with just the drums and then they go on for like a minute before the actual music starts kind of gets a little bit boring to me. But that's just my personal preference. So take that as you will. But there are three synths stacked here, like I said, and all of them do pretty much the same thing melodically. You can kind of tell just by looking at the MIDI. And again, for anybody who's not familiar with producer lingo, MIDI is the sort of programming language that we use to produce notes. So it's what the computer reads in order to play the notes. So they all do the same thing melodically, but because there are three stacked synthesizers, they're all doing individually sort of different things on their own. They give a different character to the overall sound. So I'll show you each one individually. So we're going with the top one first. So that one's really, really quiet. And then we've got the second one here. Okay. And then we got this third one. There you go, Filippo. That's one by one. So let me grab a little drink here, a little beer. All right. So each one of those is going to add just a little bit to the sound. And they each do a little bit of a different, they have their own character. So the first one that I played was Silenth. And that is this synthesizer right here. Okay. And then the next two, I believe, are both Massive. Yep. This first one here, Massive, and then the second one as well, also Massive. And there's just a little bit of EQ on each one of them, so you can see that last one that I showed you guys. I took out a lot of the bottom end of that one. Same thing here on that second one, okay? And then the third one, they're pretty similarly EQ'd, but each one has a little bit of a different character to it, as I was saying. And then all three of those are part of the drop as well. So I'm going to show you that, see what it sounds like. I'm going to play the build up. Tell that they have a big part in the drop. Matus, I do play WoW. I play on Asgalor. I'm a Death Knight tank. Although in Legion, it seems like they suck, so I might have to be switching. But anyways, okay. So let's get on here. Carlos, I'll answer that question in a second here, man. Okay. So. I guess we'll get to the rest of the drop a little bit later, but I kind of want to go through the verse right now, okay? Because I think we'll be able to kind of lead up to the drop by doing so. So let's take a look at that. The main piano part is just Nexus, and it's actually just a preset out of their default piano group. Nexus Grand Piano Soft. This is actually one of my favorite sounds, one of my favorite presets in Nexus. And I'll play that for you right here. Okay, so it's just kind of some chords with the left hand, and then kind of an arpeggio with the right hand. Kevin, that's a that's Nexus. Here, I'll show you. Let's see. It's Nexus Grand Piano Soft. Okay, right there. So it's the default patch, it's the default piano group. So anybody who has Nexus is going to have this. It's not an expansion pack. Okay. So basically, just some piano. Oh, and I'm sorry, guys. Real quick. Yeah, I was looking up WoW stuff. I'm gonna go ahead and share this, just so we can get a few more people on here. Sorry about this. I feel kind of like a goofball here. Share. All right. There we go. Okay, back to the project file. So, let's see. Piano, okay. I can kind of talk about the rest of these things here. So, yeah, so it's basically a piano, and then we've got a pad here. And that's silent. That's just some saws. It's really, really simple. With the cutoff turned down way, way low. So it's a saw wave here, a saw wave there, eight voices, some detuning to make it kind of sound real thick. Let's see. You can hear that again. Let me turn it up a little bit. Yeah, Diego. Sure, we can see the chain of the piano. It's really simple. It's just Nexus, and then this EQ right there, and then some sidechain, and that's really, really it. That's pretty much it. Yeah, Kevin. Yeah, I actually bought it. I bought Nexus. I bought Silenth. I bought Massive. Everything is legit here. Even Ableton. it's all legit. Anyways, let's get back to that pad. So, like I said, it's just a simple pad, again, with simple processing, just a little bit of EQ with, kind of the mids sort of taken out a little bit, and then the bottom end completely taken out right there. And then lastly, we've got this, this bass right here. And again, because it's kind of a sub bass, I don't know if, you're going to be able to hear this, but I'll turn it up some more so you... Hopefully you can. Oh, it's freaking loud. Okay. I've got this 12-inch subwoofer right here. So it's like shaking it's shaking my air vent. So that one is a super simple sub bass. It's a saw wave. Right there with just a single voice in silent. The cutoff is turned down. And then I've got another EQ right here, but it's basically just a filter. And some sidechain, and that's pretty much it. Somebody pointed this out actually. This wobble pad that I've got, this one right here. So that one right there, that is silent. And let's see, so it's basically just a few saws. So four voices there, cutoff is turned down a little bit. And then what gives it that wobble feel is this LFO right here, connected it to the cutoff. And I've turned the gain all the way up. So for those of you that aren't familiar with what an LFO is, It's basically a it's technically it's called a low frequency oscillator, and it's something that can control part of the synthesizer sort of repetitiously. So I'll show you what it sounds like if I turn the gain all the way off. So. So, yeah, a lesso chord, yeah. not really. Okay, Ian Bribe, what panning effects do you use on that? Nothing, man. There's no panning on there. It is completely stereo. So, yeah. But anyways, so that's that right there. That's kind of something cool that I thought that you guys wouldn't like to see. Let's see, what else do we need to talk about here? Okay. Yeah, I guess we can kind of go into some of the effects that I've got here. So there's this hard style effect that I use quite a bit in my songs, and I think that hard style is a really cool genre to sort of take little bits and pieces from and put them into different genres, because they've got these really hard effects, hence the name. But this is pretty much just a really simple effect right here. It's almost like static. And when I play the full song, I was always there for you, always took care of you, you were my king. Can't really hear it, but if you listen really, I probably can't hear it on the iPhone. But if you listen really carefully to the MP3 or a WAV file or you know, part of it on SoundCloud, you can definitely hear it. Zach, actually, we'll get into the vocals in a little bit, but I will say that Anna produces her own vocals, so she is an excellent audio engineer in terms of vocal producing. So she sends me like what I need probably like 95% of the way already produced. And then we'll get into it a little bit later, but we'll talk about that in a second, like I said. But I really just had to do a few EQs, and that's pretty much it. Gabe, this is Gabriel Mendez. This is Ableton, Ableton Live. So yeah, anyways. Yeah, I know I'm kind of being a little choppy here, kind of just bouncing around, but that right there, we pretty much went through the entire verse already. So it's really just those chords, the piano right here, piano right here, and then that main pad right there, the bass right here, and that wobble pad, and that's pretty much everything. We've got a little bit of drums, just a tambourine. And then, that's pretty much it. A little bit of clap, I guess. A clap here. And then the build-up snare, and that's pretty much it. I guess let's look at the drop. And in the drop, this is what everybody's waiting for, I think. Rodney, yes, I do master the track myself. I master all my tracks myself. I think it's easier for me to do it personally, because I'm a little bit of a control freak. So I like to do everything myself. You can ask anybody who's worked with me. But yeah, I think that it just sort of like it allows me to have complete freedom in what I want to do. So let's look at the drop, and I'm going to go through the drums first, actually. So we're going to start things off with a few clap loops. This one here, I'm going to turn it down because my ears are actually hurting, guys. Clap loop here. And then we got this one. So one's kind of like the sustain, like the loud clap, the long clap there, and then the attack, this one here, is just kind of like the snap of like the beginning of the clap, and together they sound pretty cool. So there's that. And then there's a crash cymbal here, which is basically just a simple ride or a simple crash sound. I've spread it out with this this simple delay. This is essentially what's called a Haas effect. It makes the sound hit one ear like just a couple milliseconds before the other ear actually hears the sound. So it sounds really, really stereo. Let's see. Okay, Manrico, let me show you the processing. And again, it's really simple. There's really nothing to it. So the first clap, the big clap, let's see. So this, I don't even know why I have this here. It's turned off. I've got transient master. I'm turning down the sustain, it looks like. This is a plugin by Native Instruments. But I've turned down the sustain a little bit to kind of like make it a little bit shorter. And then on the attack clap, there's literally nothing. There's no processing whatsoever. Rafael, save that question for the end, man. I'm gonna go ahead and take a whole bunch of questions at the end. So let's save that one for later, okay? And we'll get into this rest of the stuff. So there's basically that crash. We went over the claps. Big room snare. This is kind of like the Prida snare that everybody refers to. You know, that right there. Kind of a cool sound. I think they call it the Prida snare because Eric Prids, also known as Prida, kind of made that popular. Kind of sounds like an explosion, but it's pretty cool. I think it's neat. More crashes. These are just kind of single hits. You know? With a little bit of reverb, looks like, and some of the sidechain, the sidechain's on there on the crash. So there's that. Let's see, Emmanuel Sportillo. My studio monitors, they're the JBL. What are they? JBL SB 4328s, I believe. JBL 4328s. They're actually a system, so we'll get into the project in just a second here, guys, but just to answer this question quickly. They're a system, so they all link together, including the sub right there, and they have a room mode correction, so they are able to kind of read the acoustics of the room themselves and tailor themselves to your specific studio, so that's kind of cool. Manrico, do I use a multiband compression plugin like OTT or C4? I use Ableton's compression plugin, multiband compression plugin, multiband dynamics right there, and we can get to that in the end because that's on the master. But I pretty much only use multiband stuff for the on the master. Osvaldo, yeah, I'll get to that in a second. Man, you guys are all over the place, aren't you? No, I will not make you a sandwich, Dick. Aptly named. No, I'm just kidding. I'm totally just kidding, man. And then last part of the drums here that I wanted to show you guys, there's this fill right here. This is actually one of my favorite parts of the song. So there's that. Kind of cool sounding right there. I think that was actually something that the Reveal guys really, really liked a lot. It's basically just a kick snare pattern that I made, and I put a bit crusher on it. Again, that's the only processing that's on there, a bit crusher. Just a little bit right there to kind of give it this sort of crunchy, very digital sound, but it can really, really easily be overdone. So I'll show you that when it's overdone. Whoop. You know? Kind of sounds like a really old video game. But just a little bit of it sounds pretty cool, in my opinion. Okay, so that's most of the drums, and now, okay, so there's a lot of wobble stuff in this song. Let's kind of go over that. Someone pointed out this part, where is it, right in the middle of the drop. Someone pointed out, I think it was on YouTube or on SoundCloud, they pointed out this part. They pointed it out and they say that it sounds kind of like a Jaws song, and I agree. I think it does sound like Jaws. And I actually like using things that remind people of you know, other great music, and kind of sticking little snippets of them in my own music, just kind of like a quick little fill like that, you know. That right there. Just like a second or two of it, I think it makes people happy to hear something that they recognize from another, like one of their other favorite, you know, one of their other favorite artists to kind of check out. You know, hearing something like that that's similar in somebody else's song, I don't know, I think it makes people happy. I could be totally wrong there, but I like to do it, so, you know, whatever. But basically, it's just this right here. Let's see. Yeah, so I bounced it down to audio, but this is it right here. This actually did take a lot of processing, but here's it. That right there. That's Spire. Okay. And then there's a whole bunch of... there's a whole bunch of, let's see, Saturns on there. You know. Whole bunch of Saturn, lots and lots of high end, and Kickstart. It's basically Nicky Romero's sidechain thing, and then some reverb, default reverb plugin, Isotopes Imager. So it's kind of spreading the sound a little bit, right there. And then more EQ, and you end up with this right here. So, kind of interesting. Like I said, I think I like playing with stuff that other people have in their songs and sticking it into my own as just a little part. It kind of makes you think of something else, and I think it's pretty cool. So, yes, Jaws. Banana. No, that's not the right song, is it? Never mind. Okay. All right, now let's look at the leads. People are waiting for this too, I think. So here, this is the lead right here. So, the main lead obviously is the piano. And again, that's just Nexus. And I've added a lot of top end right here, but let's see what patch that is. So it's the default piano right there, and the patch is Ballad Grand Piano. And pretty much everything is left at default. I turned up a few of the controls here, and then turned down the attack a lot. I also turned off the effects because I think that was, you know, it's enough by itself. And here's what the piano sounds like by itself. So there's that. And I also added in a little bit of erosion. So this is Ableton's own effect. So it's kind of nice. Yeah, very Galantis and tritonal. Yeah, tritonal is actually, those guys are really good friends of mine. We both live in Austin, Texas, so... We've done a show together, and it's a lot of fun hanging out with them. Dave Reed and I get dinner a lot. So, another part of it is this part. So it's sort of like a tropical sound, kind of like a marimba. And again, that's also Nexus. Right there, and that is the body, I can't read it, and I can't remember what it's called, guys. Body something. marimba. So, you know, it's just a little bit of addition to the piano. Sort of adds an attack. And again, so kind of cool there. And then lastly, I've got this. I've got this, and it's another Silenth synthesizer right here. And this sound, I'm gonna warn you guys, it kind of sounds funny when I play it by itself. It kind of sounds funny by itself, but it adds just a little bit of movement to the melody. And you can't really hear it unless you're listening for it, unless you're really, really listening for it. And you know to listen to it when you listen to the entire track. Because I'll play it right now, and you know, I guarantee you, you guys aren't really going to hear it very well. I mean, you really can't hear it, but it sort of just adds a little bit of movement to the melody. So, you know, that's kind of it. So, yeah, we've gone over the sub bass, we've gone over the kick, we went over the chords, we went over the leads. I guess let's take a look at the vocals. So, the vocals right here, as I said in the beginning, you know, Anna is a really, really good vocal producer herself. So I don't really, like, I love working with her because she'll send you something that is pretty much done. Like, you as a producer, you don't have to do anything when she sends you a vocal. And it's the same thing with a few other guys that I work with. Matthew Steeper is one of them. Mike Schmidt is another. So if you guys have heard my songs, Follow and Gasoline. Gasoline was with Matt, and Follow was with Mike. But, you know, having a vocal producer as a vocalist really, really gives you a leg up, because it takes off so much work from you, but you still have to make it kind of fit into the song. So they produce their vocals really, really well, and Anna does an excellent job of it, but there's still a good amount of things that you have to do. So let's take a look at the lead vocal first. This is it right here.
I was always there for you, always took care of you. You were my king. You played the perfect part till you won my heart and got too careless to see.
You know, so it sounds really, really good already. Or it did. But I had to do a little bit of EQ work here, so I had to take out a little bit here and here. Definitely taking out some of the low end, because I just think it's not really necessary. And then I added a little bit of chorus, just to kind of spread the top end of her voice. You know, Morgan Page calls it sawdust. It's sort of like a, kind of just like a texture that some vocalists have. And Anna is definitely somebody who has it. So I use the chorus to kind of spread that off to the sides and make it sound a little wider. And then there's this second layer that I've got, and it's exactly the same thing, exactly, but I've EQ'd it differently, and I've used Isotope Nectar here, and it's got its own EQ, its own EQ. And then this harmony thing, it's adding a little bit of unison, which is basically chorus. It's on compressor and a little bit of effects. And it sounds like this.
I was always there for you, always took care of you. You were my king. You played the perfect part till you won my heart and got too careless to see.
So I'm not sure if you can tell, again, because the iPhone camera and microphone suck, but it's super, super wide, and I've taken out pretty much everything, almost everything from the mids. So Ableton has this really cool EQ, and most other DAWs will have the same thing, but I just like the way this one works. So I didn't do anything to the sides of the sound, but in the middle, I removed the majority of it. So all of the sound is only coming from the sides. So Robert Neil Guther, it doesn't phase because of just what I said. So this one right here is mostly center. And then this one right here, I've pushed everything out to the sides. So it doesn't phase because they're spread out over the stereo spectrum a little bit differently. And if that doesn't make sense, feel free to ask me more about that, and I can try and explain it a little bit better. It's a little, producer physics there. there's that, and I think there's a little bit more. Yeah, here we go. This right here is just her ad-libs. I think it's just her ad-libs. So it's that, and again, I explained this earlier, but I used that simple delay to create the Haas effect. So you can see, let me see if I can get this a little closer without it getting too blurry. The simple delay, I've turned on to time, and I've turned the left side up to 3 milliseconds, and then the right side is at 1 millisecond, and I've made it 100% wet. So basically what that means is the sound coming from the right side of the stereo spectrum is going to hit your ear 2 milliseconds earlier than the sound that's coming from the left side. So you'll hear it first on the right and then the left, but it's so close together that it just sounds as if it's coming at you at the same time, but it'll sound really, really wide. So it's a really cool effect. Now you can definitely overdo that. You're probably not even going to be able to hear, so I'm not going to show you guys, but, if I turn that like 3 second up to like 100 seconds, it's going to sound more like it's an echo. Like it's going to be like bouncing from side to side. And that does cause some phasing, and it's very, very bad for, when your music is played in mono, which is in a lot of clubs, or I think it's on FM radio. I'm not 100% sure. It might not be like that anymore. I'm not too familiar with how FM radio works anymore. So you can very easily overdo it. So you don't want to do that. It is a cool effect to use. Definitely want to use that when you need to. That's pretty much it, guys. I don't know. Does anybody have any questions? Because there's 145 of y'all watching. So feel free to ask me any questions. I'll go over more stuff if you guys want me to. I'll hang out here for another little while. So feel free to ask. If not, we can wrap things up. But let's see. That is pretty much it. So I'm gonna sort of chill out here for just a second. Oh, play it. Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's go ahead and play it.
I was always there for you. Always took care of you. You were my perfect part till you won my heart.
So I wanted to play it a little bit just for you guys so you can hear everything. But I'm going to scroll back here and kind of read over stuff. So let's see. Ian Preeb, or Pribe, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing y'all's names wrong. I'm reading these real quick. Ian asks, any resources that helped you out? Yes, YouTube, man. YouTube is most something that's helped me out. You can find a lot of really, really good resources on YouTube. I would recommend checking out Izotope's YouTube page, I-Z-O-T-O-P-E. They've got a lot of really, really interesting stuff. And follow, there's a guy named Multiplier. I'm not sure what his YouTube channel is called, but Multiplier, he gives a lot of really, really good information out to new producers. So he's really good. Let's see, Robert Neil Guther, Master Processing. Oh yeah, okay, so with that. Let me show you guys the master chain. So, okay, first I've got a little bit too much volume there, so I turned it down 1 dB. I don't even know if that's making very much of a difference. Compressor, just kind of compressing everything very, very lightly. You know, I think this is 3.8 dBs. That's almost nothing. I don't even know if it's doing anything. Let's see, during the drop. Yeah, barely anything. And then this EQ here. This is actually a very, very important point. So you notice I've got these little notches, tiny little notches here, and here. So in the drop, I have to turn this down because it's going to get really, really, really loud. In the drop, there are some resonant frequencies, and it's actually throughout the entire song, but especially in the drop because it's the loudest part. There's some resonant frequencies that if I turn it up, so you guys can hear that kind of like really, really loud, kind of harsh whistle sound. You know, and if I move the EQ, I'm not gonna be able to do it very well, but if I move the EQ around just a few little a few hundred or maybe even a few ten kilohertz, you won't be able to hear that anymore. It's right at that one spot. So, oops. I don't know, maybe you can hear it a little bit. But I think I've taken out more. Well, maybe not. Okay. So there's that. I think that is really important to do because what that's doing is there's like a buildup of sound right there and there and there and there. There's this buildup of sound where if you play it really loud in a club and you don't take a little bit of that out, it's going to get very, very harsh on people's ears. So you have to remove some of those resonant frequencies so that they don't hurt people's ears and people aren't like, you know, turn that shit down. Because you definitely don't want that reaction to your music. Okay, then a multi-band dynamics. This is just turning up things. This is almost like the OTT, if some of y'all are familiar. Somebody asked me that earlier, but it's similar to the OTT. Manrico, it's not really that important because, I mean, as you can see, they're pretty much turned up all by almost the exact same amount. So if I just turned up everything about, what is the kind of the average is like six dBs, it might honestly do the same thing. I don't do a whole lot with that. And then another utility to turn things down just a little bit there. This is the Izotope Exciter. This combo right here, Izotope Exciter and Izotope Imager, are two things that I use all the time, like all the time. For the Imager, I pretty much use this preset. It's called Modern Width, and then I adjust it accordingly. Usually I leave the sub bass alone at minus 16.5. Same thing with this one. I usually leave those two alone because you don't need to really make those any more stereo. In fact, bringing it down some more might help out. And then the upper two, I just kind of push a little bit higher. I'm not sure what the default is, and this might actually be the default, but I usually mess with these two, so I turn it up to kind of see how it sounds a little bit. And then the exciter, same thing. So I'll use this preset right here, smooth high end, and then I'll change these settings right here. I'll usually leave the bottom, well, it's kind of 4.2k and below. I'll leave that alone, and the top end is really what I'll excite. Just a little bit of push there, it kind of gives it that crispiness at the top. Okay, and then okay. So I actually, it's weird, but with Isotope, they're very touchy, and if I don't have these this minus two right here, it'll clip. I can show you that. It's gonna clip right here. Right there. It's gonna clip there, and that's annoying. So I have to turn it down, and then right back up afterwards. So there's a minus two and then a plus two, and then finally, the last couple of things here is a glue compressor. This is the stock Ableton compressor. Not really a whole lot that I can say here. If you know anything about compression, all I do is I turn up the threshold and turn up the makeup gain. So I turn up the threshold a little bit until it starts getting a little quiet, then I turn up the makeup gain. And then I turn up the threshold a little bit more until it gets quiet again, and then I turn up the makeup gain some more. And it's kind of a push and pull there with whether or not it sounds good. It's a little difficult to say, but you know, it's a little difficult to say exactly what I'm doing there. But it's just kind of, I don't know. It's kind of you have to get used to, you know, what you're doing and how you're hearing it. And finally, I've got the Isotope Ozone 7 maximizer here, and I got an IRC 2. I've turned down the threshold to about 3.3. Definitely always want to keep this right here, no matter what song you're working on, always want to keep it at minus 0.1 dB. That is the highest and the lowest you want to go. That's just the way, you know, most EDM is written. It's brick walled. That's how you get your, brick wall sort of like, kind of, yes, thanks Carnage, right. Robert, that's how you get your sausage sort of feel. Excuse me, but I think it's sort of like the type of sound that we're going for all right here. So you know, in EDM, it needs to be loud. It needs to sound like it's like about to blow the speakers. That's kind of the sound that is popular today. And you know, if you don't really do that, your music is going to sound a little bit more quiet than everybody else's. A lot of times, if you're actually sending tracks to a label, and yours sounds quiet compared to everybody else's out there, they're not going to really pay attention to yours quite as much, because you want it to be louder. You want it to, like, you know, hit them right in the chest. You know, the bass hit them right in the chest as soon as things start coming in. Because if your stuff sounds quiet, it's going to sound weak. And that's the last thing that a label's going to want, is a weak track. You know what I mean? So, yeah. Okay. And yeah, and then that's really it. Let's see. So I'm going to scroll up here again. Sorry. So questions. Feel free to ask me, guys, right now, because I've stopped going over stuff, so I'll answer your questions. Let's see. Craig Christian, reverb on drop leads, what do you look for? You know, man, I don't really put a ton of it on there, but I guess,
Like with the leads, with my leads right here, the piano, there's no reverb, none. See, when I stop it, it doesn't play. There's nothing else. So there's absolutely no reverb on there. However, on the chords, there's quite a bit. But there's actually a trick to it. I have sidechained the reverb here to the chords themselves. So the only time that you hear the reverb is when the chords are not playing. So and then there's some parts where I've actually turned it off. But so that's why you hear it a lot when I stop the song. Okay. You can hear it when I stop playback. So you just hear it in these like little tiny gaps right there. You hear it a little bit, and that's pretty much it. But yeah, I use the default Ableton, or I'm sorry, the factory Ableton reverb. And people say that thing sucks, but I use it all the time. I don't know, whatever. So yeah, okay. Let's see. I'm scrolling down. Are you Select FL Studio OSCan? No, man. This is Ableton Live. I'm not super crazy about FL Studio, guys. You know. I tried it like a few years ago and I could not do a thing in that. I don't know. Maybe I'm just stupid, but I couldn't even create like a 4-on-4 kick pattern. I had no idea what was going on with that thing. So, sorry to everybody who likes it. I know that a lot of people use it and it's awesome for them, but it sucked for me. So I don't use that stuff. Sorry guys. Brian, yes, I play World of Warcraft. I'm a dork. You gotta do what you gotta do, man. Let's see. Okay. Do I use massive reverb on the chord? So yeah. So Max Carlberg, we kind of just went over that, man. Feel free to ask me more about that though. Raphael Tucker, Tom and James recommended the technique where you use the reverb in the synth after the processing, the reverb sounds big. Do you agree with this method? Yeah, I mean, you can. There's no wrong way. Raphael, there's no wrong way to do things. So if you can get that to sound good, yeah, go for it, man. I typically don't do that. I typically don't do that, but, you know, you got to do what you got to do, I guess. Wow, it's already been an hour, guys. So they wanted me to do this for 20 minutes. It seems like the questions aren't flying in quite as quickly as they were earlier. So I think I might call it. Please feel free to continue the conversation here. And I will get back to you. I get back to 100% of the people that ask questions on my Facebook page. So please feel free to follow me at facebook.com/NoahNeimanMusic. Or you can also follow me on Twitter and Instagram. SoundCloud and Snapchat with just at Noah Neiman. I promise you, I do get back to 100% of the people that send me tweets or messages or comments, especially comments. I love getting back to you guys about that. So get on it. Shout out to everybody who's picked up their copy of Told You So. If you haven't, what are you doing, man? No, I'm just kidding. But seriously. anyways, so you can pick it up at Beatport on iTunes. You can stream it at Spotify. It's out all over the place. Check it out on YouTube or check it out on SoundCloud. Thank you so much for those of you that have actually bought your copy, though. I really, really do appreciate it. Every single one of you that buys a copy helps us out on the iTunes and Beatport charts. So big ups to you. You're awesome. And with that, I'm going to close things off, guys. Thank you so much. I hope this was informative. I know, again, I was a little bit kind of all over the place with the explanations, but I will certainly get back to anybody who comments or who tweets me. So get at me. Love you guys. See ya.